In the last class, we were looking at optimization schemes. So this is a nice reference here, Hinton's slides and his video lectures. You can go through these. So we were discussing about gradient descent algorithm. So what we are doing here actually is we are trying to optimize error, which is a function of weights, right? If you remember, we have some target value, some target vector, minus some estimated y, which is a function of inputs as well as hidden weights, and many non-linearities and all. So we are trying to optimize, okay, actually this is squared error loss, but we might not only optimize squared error loss, we might also optimize other kinds of loss functions which are a function of t comma y, right, x comma w. So any kind of loss function could be optimized using gradient descent scheme, provided that the loss function is differentiable. So the basic philosophy is like this. You have your optimal point somewhere here, which you want to reach. Let me draw it with red. This is your W star, which you want to reach. And how will you go about achieving it? You randomly initialize your W, maybe here, then you find out the slope, and then you descend along the slope. So the slope is in this direction. You descend so that the weight decreases, right? You change your W such that the new W reduces your error. So dou E upon dou W is the slope. You go in the direction of negative slope, where the error will decrease. And you will finally reach this point. Now, this is a simple philosophy, but how do we do it efficiently? We want to minimize the effort required to reach the optimal point. Minimizing in the sense, okay, can I minimize my computational load? Can I minimize the time taken to achieve the optimal point? So in this way, this is primarily, and also one very important thing, can I make it optimal for unseen data, which means generalization. Can I ensure generalization? Right? So these are a few criteria to decide whether my optimization scheme is good or not. Okay. So it should achieve low error rates, means it should achieve the minimum point, the best minimum point. It should not get stuck in these plateaus or local minima. So that is one criterion to decide that it is a good optimization scheme. Second is it should generalize well. Third is that it should do it very efficiently, in least time, with least computations. Okay, so given that, let us look at one example profile of our error function which might degrade our efficiency. So we discussed this profile, this one. So we have, okay, so let us consider squared error loss, which has a quadratic bowl, means quadratic profile, but it's in two dimensions, so it looks like a bowl. But it is not square, it is like an ellipse. So it is something like this, right? In one direction, it is more curved than the other. So this is the direction in which it is more curved. So let us say if I'm here, my gradient is in this direction, right? So which is almost perpendicular to the direction where I should actually go, the W star, right? So if I use simply the gradient descent method, it will keep oscillating like this, and it will be very inefficient. So what is happening is that it is oscillating in this direction where you have very steep gradients. So let me plot a view from this direction. A view from this direction. How will it look like? It is very steep, right? And it keeps oscillating. Right? Let us draw a view from this direction. In this direction, it is less steep. Okay, maybe let me draw it straight. It is very less steep. Your gradients are very small. This is your W star, this is your W star. Your gradient is very small, but this is the right direction to go. This one, your error is progressing very, very slowly because all the energy is going in oscillating about the steep portion, right? So taking this example, I derive or I engineer an update scheme, which is like this. Move quickly in directions with small but consistent gradients, and move slowly in directions with large but inconsistent gradients, right? So we found a quadratic bowl like this, and we found a quadratic bowl like this, right? So here my algorithm is just oscillating here like that. Right, and here it is progressing very slowly, very slowly, very slowly. So what you find is that in this direction it is consistent but small descent. In this direction it is a large descent but very inconsistent, right? You are changing directions very fast. So taking inspiration from the Newtonian mechanics, can you derive something? Okay, as the, let us assume this is a ball in which our ball is descending. We have a ball and the ball is falling across along this slope. So when my ball is here, it will, as it is descending, it will gradually pick up more and more speed, right? It will speed up because of the acceleration due to gravity. And in this one, it is just bumping along the wall, so it is dissipating energy, means it is becoming slower and slower and slower, right? So this is the basic basic understanding to by which we design our learning scheme. And towards the end of learning, reduce the learning rate. Let's say along this bowl, as our error is decreasing, if I do not, let us say if I have a bowl on which a ball is placed, ball is descending, if there is no friction, right, the ball will keep oscillating. But if you add friction, the ball will gradually slow down near the minimum point. It will oscillate for some time and it will then slow down. But if there is more friction near the minimum point, then it will very quickly stabilize. That is the idea. So this whole scheme is derived from Newtonian mechanics, and I think that is the right way to imagine, to understand the concept. Okay, so let's go to the next slide. So this is the algorithm which is popular. It is called momentum-based gradient descent. So your normal ordinary gradient descent is simply W minus alpha times dou E upon dou W, or which means also, so this thing is your basically, alpha is your learning rate, delta W. Right? But in this case, we are learning from Newtonian mechanics. What we are saying is, let's say V is my velocity or momentum, right? So as soon as I get some delta W, this gets added to the velocity. If you remember, right. Yeah, V is equal to U plus AT. This is in Newtonian mechanics, right? Your final velocity or speed, okay, let's say velocity, initial velocity, and this is your acceleration. So your delta W acts like your acceleration, V is your initial velocity or previous velocity, and you update your V. This is your new velocity, which is old velocity plus the acceleration. In this way, if your delta W's are consistently in one direction, you keep adding momentum and you keep increasing your speed in that direction. And this is your weights are updated based on this formula. Something like S is equal to ut plus half kt square. Analogous to that in Newtonian mechanics. Okay, so this is the basic idea. There are more and more schemes which are all based on heuristics. This is RMS prop. This is do it yourself. Do it yourself means you read it. It's very easy to understand. The idea is same, that you want to increase your speed if the gradients are consistent in that direction. But this RMS prop, it uses some kind of weighing. It averages over previous gradients and weighs the learning rate so that your learning rate is optimal. Okay. Fine. So that was about optimization scheme. Now, given a particular scheme, given a particular hyperparameter, we saw how to descend along the gradient. Now, how do you find the best learning rate? Another popular approach, but this is more general, not just about learning rate, but actually best. So, not just learning rate, but any hyperparameter. What are hyperparameters? Hyperparameters are those quantities in your model which are constant for a model, right? The weights are called parameters, the tunable parameters which you train during the training, which get updated during the training. Hyperparameters are those parameters which are constant throughout the training, which you decide beforehand and then later it is not changed. The examples are your model architecture. What does that mean? Let us say you have a neural network. How many layers you want to use? How many neurons per layer you want to use? Right? What else? What other hyperparameters could be there? Yes, learning rate, let us say eta, the learning rate or alpha, the learning rate, if you're not changing it. Or you could define a schedule for reducing your alpha. Let us say my alpha is in the beginning this, but then I decay it. Let's say after every 10 epochs, I make my learning rate 80%, something like that. So that will also, that 80% quantity is also a hyperparameter, right? What else? Yes, the lambda in regularization, which you saw in the book, PRML book. That could be a hyperparameter. What else?
Thresholds for activations.
Thresholds for activations. Did we use any thresholds?
Any other parameters in the activation functions?
Okay. We have not seen any in this course, but if there are, okay, let us say there are. Maybe in rectified linear units, ReLU, the function looks like 0 before, 0 for negative and 1 for positive, means the same as x for positive. But what you can do is in this, then for negative, when you say 0, you can make it not exactly 0, but alpha times x. Alpha times x, where alpha is a constant. So then in that case, alpha becomes a hyperparameter. So basically, your this thing looks like. Your ReLU function, the leaky ReLU, it's called leaky ReLU because it's leaking at the negative edge. It looks something like this. So here this is y is equal to x. Here it is y is equal to alpha times x, where alpha is much smaller than 1. Then this alpha could be hyperparameter. Okay, what else? This is a leaky ReLU. We have not discussed this, but okay. So alpha will be a hyperparameter. So in this way, you can have so many hyperparameters. Now, how do you optimize your hyperparameters? You are not learning them during training. Rather, they are deciding your training. How do you optimize them? There are different schemes to optimize them. Very popular are some heuristic approaches. And if you want to do more principled way of optimizing your hyperparameters, you have got Bayesian approaches. So, but we are not discussing Bayesian approaches right now. We are discussing some easy to understand approaches, which are one very popular approach is okay. Let's do some intuition. If I have a hyperparameter, let us say a hyperparameter, maybe eta. Eta is constant, so eta is my hyperparameter. How do I find the best value of eta? I will choose an eta, let's say 0.1. I'll train my model with that eta, and then I'll get some training error, finally, which is very small, right? And then I will do testing. On testing, I will get some error, right? Now, with maybe let us say it is also very small. There is no overfitting. It's also very small. Then what will you do? You will think, is it the right value of a hyperparameter? Maybe I choose some other hyperparameter. Let's say you choose 0.2 eta. Again, run the same experiment. You will get some other value of, let me draw it like a diagram. You have a hyperparameter, HYP, and you have the error on, let us say, error train and error test. So let us say I have a parameter value lambda 1, I got an error of 0.3. And with another hyperparameter lambda 2, I got a value 0.4. Another hyperparameter lambda 3, I got a value 0.2. So finally, which is the hyperparameter which you would like to choose? Huh? Pardon? Lambda 3? Okay, good point. So this is, training error is not sufficient to tell me which is the best hyperparameter. So I will use test. Let us say on test error, the error was 0.5 here. The error was 0.6 here. And the error was 0.52 here. Which one will you choose? Lambda 1. Why not lambda 3? Okay, so lambda 3 is not generalizing to unseen data, right? It is overfitting. Very good. And I disagree that we should use lambda 1. Can anybody support me? I disagree to use lambda 1. The answer is there in the slides. Huh? Okay. But still, yeah, I'm cheating. So, I give you practice problems and I give you the final exam. And then you're optimizing on the final exam. What brings you the best, best marks in the final exam, right? That is not correct. But what I should do, I should use my practice problems only to test myself. We discussed the concept of mock test, right? So when you give JEE exam, you do not You do not check your learning on the JEE exam itself, like on the day of exam. No, you do it beforehand with the help of mock tests. So you need mock tests. That mock test is the validation set. So what you do, you have your training data, let us say 100 samples. So you separate some samples and use them as mock tests. Do not use all the practice problems for practice or for learning, but keep some practice problems like mock test. And then you, okay, so I have to create another column here called e-validation. So now my errors will be, let's say, 0.49 on this, 0.61 on this, 0.51 on this. Then I can say, yes, I can use my lambda 1. And most likely, if your data is of equal distribution, which means that the level of difficulty of mock test is same as the level of difficulty of actual JEE exam. In other words, the level of difficulty of validation set is same as the level of difficulty of the test set. Then you can say you will get approximately similar scores, right? That's what I'm getting, 0.49 versus 0.5 and almost similar scores. Whereas the training error is much different, right? So this is the concept of validation set. So I have taken out few questions or few samples from the training data to use as validation data. I do not train on the validation set. I just monitor my performance on the validation set. What does that mean? While training means while update, for updating my weights, I do not use validation set. I update my weights using the training set, and then let's say after one epoch. What is an epoch? Epoch means when I see all the training samples once. That is called an epoch. I think I should have. What is an epoch? Epoch means seeing all training samples once. So this is an iterative training, right? In an iterative training, what you do is you learn on the whole set. So you update your weights, and then you again learn on the whole set, update your weights, so that when you train on all the training samples, you see them all once. That is called one epoch. Okay. So here, when you complete your one epoch, then you test on the validation set and see what is my error, and you monitor your error. Okay. And wherever, okay, let us say in this case, in hyperparameter tuning, when you get your best validation error for different hyperparameters, then you choose the one, the hyperparameter with the least validation error, and use that as your good hyperparameter. Okay, so now, is this idea clear? Is this idea clear? I have a question. How do you choose lambda 1, lambda 2, and lambda 3? How do you choose lambda 1, lambda 2, and lambda 3? Huh? One very common answer could be, one very intuitive answer could be, let us say this is my learning rate eta, and this is my error as a function of eta. Let's say this is the eval, validation error as a function of eta. So I can, let's say, I can choose 10 values between 0 and 0.2, right? And I train my system, my model, with all these values and find out my validation error. So I may get validation error of this, and here I may get validation error of this, here I may get this, here I may get this. Something like this, right? So this is called grid search. What does that mean? I have my search space. It's a linear search space in this case. I uniformly sample it. sorry, I uniformly choose my points on it. I'm not doing any random sampling. It's all deterministic. And I evaluate my algorithm on all those points, and I find the profile and choose the minimum. That is my answer. Is this a good approach? In some cases. So it looks like a good approach, but empirically it is found that it is very inefficient. A more efficient approach is random sampling. Deep learning is all random. So random sampling. So how do you do random sampling? You define your range. Let's say my eta is between 0 to 0.2. And you randomly, let's say I choose my eta as uniform between 0, 0.2. Right? Uniformly, I pick any random value. Let's say sometimes it could be this, sometimes it could be this, sometimes it could be this, sometimes it could be this. And what people have observed is that very less number of samples itself you can attain the optimal point, right? It is also means people give some justifications, but okay, so this is the final result, that if you do a random hyperparameter optimization, then you are able to do achieve the good performance or an optimal point, an optimal value of hyperparameter very quickly. Good question. How do you know you have achieved the optimal if you have not searched the whole space? Who will answer?
But you can't start the whole space.
Yeah. So how do you go about doing that? It's very simple. You cannot search the whole space, but you can approximate. Okay, if I am sampling large number of points, then it approximates the whole space, right? How do you go about doing that? So you start making a table, eta versus error validation, fine. You choose a value of eta, find the value of error, choose a value of eta, find the value of error, and keep track of the optimal value, which is your optimal value. And you keep doing it for whatever number you want, 1,000 times, 10,000 times, does not matter. And then you want to find, let us say over 1,000 runs, I got some value of optimal, right? And let us say in the beginning 20 runs, you got some value of optimal. And you compare them. You compare them. And you will find that the optimal which you obtained in the first 20 runs is very close to the one which you obtained after 1,000 runs, let us say. Right? And another, on the other hand, if you do a grid search, so create a grid of 10 junctions or 10 points, and further create a, keep splitting it further and further in a deterministic way, and then finally you attain a grid of 1,000 points. So what you will find is that the best result which you are getting with 1,000 points is very far from the best result which you get from 20 points, let us say. Which means the speed of achieving the optimal or the efficiency is very less with grid search.
Can we run like another gradient descent for eta?
Yes, so basically, if your eta is differentiable, you can do it. Because eta is appearing in the final update rule.
No, it's not okay.
It is possible if your hyperparameter is a differentiable parameter, means your total error function is differentiable with respect to the hyperparameter. Then you can optimize it. Yes, but it is not always the case. That is, the number of neurons, it's discrete by nature. Number of layers, it is discrete by nature, not differentiable, right? Okay, so this is called hyperparameter search. There are many popular schemes to do that. You can, I will post some good references where you can read further. Let's come to the next topic, validation. We just now discussed validation set. So how do you do efficient implementation? So people generally, they have huge amounts of data for training. So what they do is they have the training data, they run one epoch on the training data, then they test on the validation data, means how much is the accuracy, and then move further to the next epoch, right? So people can use, if you have lots of resources, you can use a separate machine for validation, because validation is time consuming. You have to run over the all the validation examples, that validation samples, and then find out the eval, right? You can use a separate machine, like separate CPU or GPU, but that is not always the case. You may not have resources that much. So you can, so what you do then, in that case, you can reduce the size of your validation set. Instead of validating on a huge amounts of data, you can take a smaller amount of data, and so that your check is fast, your computations are less. Next could be reduce the frequency of checks. Instead of doing it after each epoch, you can do it after maybe 5 epochs, after 10 epochs, 20 epochs, right? So, and also what you can do is, in the beginning you test over after, let us say, 20 epochs, later you test over 15, after 15 epochs, later, means you keep reducing the gap of your validation, okay, or keep increasing the frequency as the learning progresses. Okay, stopping criterion, when to stop your training. So generally, people put a threshold on the training error. But just now we noticed that that is not a good way. We can put a threshold on the validation error. That is a better idea. Okay, let me here. I think I have a slide on that. Okay, maybe very late here. Okay, so stopping criterion. So generally what trend is seen? Generally what we observe is something like this. This is the error, and this is the number of epochs, which means as the training is progressing, in the beginning I have large error, as the training is progressing, my error is reducing. So this is basically e-train. How will it proceed further? It will keep going down and down and down, but as the training progresses too far, the rate of decay decreases, right? This is my e-train. I know that I do not want to go very far because it starts overfitting. So I keep track of my validation error. How does the validation error look like? It is generally, it is more than the training error because it is on unseen data. It is also reducing in the beginning, right? It keeps reducing until it reaches a kind of saturation where it no longer decreases. In some cases, it may also start increasing because of overfitting, right? So we want to find the point which achieves the best validation error. As soon as I reach here, I know that I do not have to go any further. So I stop here. I stop here, right? Now, is this a good approach? Certainly better than tracking the training error, but can we do still better? Yes. How do I know when my validation error has stopped improving? One thing is, if my change in, okay, let me first write it down. This is my eval. So if my change in error, if my change in eval, the magnitude of it, if it falls below a threshold, then I say it has stopped improving. But it is possible that it stops improving for some time and then start again increasing, right? So I reach a plateau. How do I avoid that situation? Because as soon as I hit a plateau, your algorithm will think, oh, it has stopped decreasing. In some cases, it might also increase for some time. Means it might be like a rough terrain. So a better approach is, do not take decision of stopping just based on one epoch. You wait for few epochs, let us say 10 epochs or 5 epochs. So only if the validation error does not improve at all in next 5 or 10 epochs, then you say, I think I should stop now. Okay, so this is called deciding your stopping criterion, not based on single epoch, but by monitoring several epochs. Okay, next is weight initialization. How do I initialize my original weights? If you remember in gradient descent, we start from some random weights. Okay, so generally the trend is you start from random weights. Why not use same weights? Why do we use random weights? Why not use some same, let's say, one, all the weights are one? Okay, yeah, good point. So if I use same weights, let us say, this is my W, I1, I0 times X0 summation, right? If I use, if my W I1 comma all is equal to W I2 comma all, sorry, what am I writing? If my W I1 equal to, sorry, I1 dash if my WI1 all, which means, okay, my W is a matrix, this is a W matrix, if all the rows are same, if this row is equal to this row is equal to this row, then what will happen, the updates, my delta W will also be same for each row. So that is how all my rows will update in the same way, and I will never learn diverse things. So what does that mean geometrically? Geometrically, it means if this is my X1, X2 space, what will happen here is all my W's will be the same line. Right? All my W's will be the same line. They are not learning different things. So that is why I need my weights should be different. Now, okay, what should be the magnitude of the weights? If I say, let my weights be, uh, 2.1, 2.2, 3.1, 4.3, they are random, but they have large values. What is the harm in that? Overfitting might not be there. It's initialization. We are initializing the weights. It is not the final outcome. No, W1 and W2, that means if both is 2 times X1 and 2 times X2, or it is 5 times X1, 5 times X2. Slope is same. Unstable training. Why does that happen? So my gradients will become very large, right? Even before that, even in the forward pass, I will attain, okay, what is my H, let us say here, HI1 is equal to this, right? So my X will have some value, let's say between 0, 1, right? If my weights are large, what will be H? H will be a large value. Now, if H is large, what is V? Let us say sigmoid function. In sigmoid function, what is V? If H is large, what is V? V will lie somewhere here, right? What does that mean? It will not train because it is on a it's on the far right end. I mean, it's very deep into the plateau. When does it learn well? It learns well It's a green color. It learns well in this region. But in this region, it learns poor. Right? Because your slopes are almost zero. That is why if you use the W's to be very large, then your H will become very large. So your V will also become highly saturated. It won't learn very well. It happens when you have more fanin. What is the meaning of fanin? Fanin means you have a neuron. How many connections are there? How many input connections are there? That is a fanin. If it is large fanin, then there is more chance that you will overshoot and your training will become unstable. Okay. Okay, good point. If you use ReLU function, then you won't see plateau, right? But still, your training will become unstable because your gradients will be large, right? That problem will still be there. No, weights could be negative also. That is why I said when there is a large fan in, then there is more probability that you have more weights of some sign which they multiply and they give you unstable. Next very important concept, I think you must have seen this concept in your third assignment, right? You have your n going from 0 to 127, right? Which means that your n to the power 20 or n to the power 11 becomes a really large quantity. So your input is very large. So what do you see then? So okay. We will come to that. Let us go through the theory first. Shifting of data helps. Okay, if your data is, let us consider this example. So, let us consider this example. You have one sample, 101, 101, and you map it to the value 2. This is your x, this is your target. And another x, 101, 99. And you map it to 0. How will you go about this? You will say W1 times 101 plus W2 times 101 is equal to 2. W1 times 101 plus W2 times 99 is equal to 0. So how will the slopes look like? So both these equations, their slopes are only slightly different, right? So something like this. Their slopes are slightly different. Therefore, what you get is your error surface becomes very oblong in one direction. So it becomes difficult to learn, especially with the gradient descent scheme. It becomes very difficult to learn. So what we do is we always prefer circular learning surfaces, right? Where you can very easily learn. How can you achieve it? By just subtracting 100 from everything. If I subtract 100 from all the values, minus 100, minus 100, how will it look like? It will become 1, 1 goes to 2. 1, comma, minus 1 goes to 0. And you know that your W1 and W2 are both 1, comma 1. Right? W1 is 1, W2 is also 1. So this is called shifting the data to zero mean. This helps. Second is scaling. How does scaling help? So scaling helps, for example, if I have, this also happened in your assignment. You have W0 multiplying with 1, W1 multiplying with n, which could take values between 0 to 127. But you have your W20 or W19 multiplying with values from 0 to the power 128 or 127 to, sorry, 0 to the power 20 to, you have your, you have your W, let us say W1 into X plus so on, W19 X or N, whatever it is, 19. So this X goes between 0 to 127. This X also goes between 0 to 127, but X to the power 19 goes between 0 to 127 power 19, which is a huge number, right? And I'm sure that your training must have crashed miserably. What did you do then? So you do data normalization. So what we do is, we are running out of time. Different variances for different dimensions. So you make each dimension as unit variance. So you divide the X by the variance, divide each dimension with the variance. So it means this input you divide by something like 127. This you divide by 127 by 127 to the power 19, something like this, right? It will help bring all the dimensions in similar range. So your this thing will become this, right? And then it's a circular error surface. It's easier to learn there. This is the concept of data normalization. Overall, it becomes bringing the data to zero mean and then compressing it from all directions to make it univariance. Okay, I think we can stop here because